All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Escape Gaming versus Team Empire. We're here with game number two. This is the opening series of the Global Grand Masters Season 1 playoffs. This is an 8-team double-elim bracket. Empire Escape Gaming, our first matchup here. Liquid versus Power Rangers coming up after this later today. Then we will have Alliance versus Flipside and Vega versus Ad Finum. So a pretty nice little bracket here and a lot of games to look forward to. I am Ziori, joined again by Mott Pax. Trent, how you feeling here coming into game number two? Team
Empire. I'm feeling like things are looking pretty familiar. This is Earth Spirit Dazzle once more for Escape Gaming. We're going to have another Timbersaw. Who knows which lane they'll go to. And then this time they have snagged up the Slayer Dire for themselves on Team Empire. So two very active heroes during a fight. Like just, hard to keep track of. Disappearing into the fog and then reinitiating, coming back in. Tons of damage. Like kind of those like sustained long duration kind of fights, but at the same time you also have that like crushing instant initiation of a Slardar, so just very scary overall right now from Team Empire, even with just the first two heroes. But I gotta say, I'm a little perplexed by the draft. Escape Empire, having that first pick.
I think Earth Spirit Dazzle is obviously their comfort zone, and I don't think those are the heroes that really had a problem last game. Like Yapzor did a lot in the early game. Syndrin, okay, he missed a couple of grays, but overall Dazzle is never going to be a bad pick in the hands of Escape Gaming. Empire, I see why they went back to the Timbersaw. I think he fares pretty well against these two in general. Not an easy hero to gank without a hard stun, or someone like a Lion with a Hex to interrupt that Timber Chain. The silence is annoying, but it's a skill shot. Easier said than done. A lot of other more reliable spells that lock down the Timbersaw a bit more effectively. I like that Empire went for the Slardar here. Take it out of the hands of Escape Gaming. We have switch sides. This is one of few tournaments that still does mandatory side switch, where a lot of tournaments now, when you win the coin flip, it's all about choice. In between games, you alternate who gets to choose which side or pick priority. So you can have a series where it's the same side and pick setup every single game if both teams prefer the opposites, whereas one team prefers first pick and the other team prefers second, and one team prefers radiant, the other team prefers dire. That's how the whole series is going to go. In this tournament, it actually does oscillate. So now Escape, that minus armor is a little more scary when you're on the dire side, Roche Pit a little more accessible, and I see why Empire maybe want to just deny the Slardar altogether and play it for themselves.
10 seconds. Yeah, I think Empire's draft just overall has been fantastic today. I think they've definitely done their research. I mean, they played in the regionals versus Escape. I'm sure they watched plenty of their games while that was all going on as they moved into those upper parts of the playoffs too. But this like Necrophos ban, I think, is so fantastic. Every time you have the Timbersaw, they did this last game too. But I just think it's important to note that it is one of those routes that they'll take as Escape when they have this Earth Spirit Dazzle. They want to move into that like quick early pushing strategy using the double heal from Dazzle, and maybe they'll grab him an IO too if that had been left in the pool. Just overall, I just think Team Empire reading them really well. Like first phase Darkseer ban, and then they're going to make sure that they're not going to get a first phase Faceless Void. And to me, whenever I watch Escape and they don't have Darkseer or Faceless Void, they seem to suffer. Honestly, it's definitely just like maybe not even so much a comfort hero for Kezu, but he is just like so goddamn good at those two heroes that it seems like they can't always replicate it with other ones.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. I would agree with you there. Some interesting bans from Empire, though. They're third and fourth. Necrophos, in particular. Lone Druid, one that Koikbutt likes to play quite a bit. But whoa, daddy, they go with the Admiral Kunkka. That's an interesting choice. Probably a support hero, I would imagine. But some good setup here. X-Torrent. Nice for the Timbersaw, nice for the Slardar. So there is some natural synergy already. Nice beefy lineup with three strength heroes. 10 seconds
remaining. Man, I got dumpstered twice, two games in a row yesterday by a wannabe attacker Kunkka. Going that armlet build, and I queued right into him again. Oh, God. It's a good hero. That hero is very obnoxious. He just goes in with his X marks the spot combo, and you are correct, more than likely to be that four-roll support Kunkka. Does extremely well these days. I'm not expecting any sort of tinker shenanigans that we mentioned last game, but you never know. He just offers a lot of control. I mean, we used to have that combo with like a Shadow Demon or something there, but I don't think Empire, they're not a team I've actually seen do this combination. So definitely, one game number one, maybe stepping out of their own comfort zone a little bit here.
Absolutely. I mean, this is the upper bracket of a double elim, so you do have a little bit of flexibility. You're up one game in a best of three series. I think you're absolutely right. If you want to experiment, this is the time to do it, because it's still an official, the opposition is not going to be in that scrim mindset where they might be doing something really crazy as well. So it's totally plausible that Empire just want to spread their wings and try something a little different. Now, they could also have something else in store. This could be the beginning of a crazy fourth pick, like a Shadow Demon or something that sets it all up. And they're going to do a ridiculous roaming duo, or you never know. It could still be a core Kunkka. They could set this up with a, you know, off lane Slardar, safe lane Kunkka, mid lane Timbersaw. It's funky. I don't think it's very likely, but it's still possible. Maybe part of the reason why Escape thought so long about that third pick, and they did settle on a Juggernaut. Remaining.
Yeah, I think it also just right away up against Earth Spirit and Dazzle, you can already see a lot of good moments for it. The Rum is going to be really nice up against that Magnetize, just helping your whole team survive through all that damage that's coming out over time throughout the duration of the fight. You're going to have the X to bring him back if he gets too aggressive. Like, let's say you're camping the mid lane and just looking out to save him, and you get a harassing roll the boulder in. Well, suddenly he gets X'd up around that 4 or 5 minute mark, and Earth Spirit's just dead. And then the Dazzle TP Grave, right? He just hands that off to somebody, they start TPing home, you guys are out of stuns, and it's just one more hero to make sure you can bring them on back using that X marks the spot. So I just think, yeah, overall, a little bit of experimentation, but also just solid. It's not like it's a throw or anything, for sure.
Yeah, I mean, I do like the sustainability that Escape have picked up as well. Jug is pretty good at just resetting in general. You know, he gets caught by a Slardar stun, as long as he doesn't get completely bursted down, can probably get the Omni Slash off. Same kind of thing against the Kunkka. They will pick up the Rubick, though. A nice support to have in tandem with the Kunkka. Good roaming duo there. Easy setup. You can just go Telekinesis into Torrent. You can go X into Telekinesis into Torrent. All sorts of things. And Fade Bolt, a nice little bit of burst damage to follow up and actually help find those kills. A decent amount of spells to steal also. Dazzle, Earth Spirit, Jug all have something that Rubick will be happy to pull into his arsenal if you can ever get your hands on Omni Slash or that Healing Ward. Yeah, you'll be feeling pretty good as the Grand Magus. So, nice solid pick here for Empire. Invoker. And now the Invoker. There's your Koikva hero for Escape. They have pretty good damage now. Solid team fight, but I feel like they're a little bit light on just straight up lockdown. I mean, you've got Cold Snap on the Invoker. You've got some annoying slows like Ice Wall. Earth Spirit has a stun. You've got the slow from Dazzle, but you know, they've got AoE Crush from Slardar. You've got AoE Torrent from Kunkka. Even just having a Telekinesis on Rubick that can drop a stun on somebody. I feel like Empire just have better control in these team fights. Reserve time.
And then the question is, what sort of way are they going to end it up with? Like, what offlane hero can you get for Kezu that's left that offers that control? Well, there goes the Batrider, and then the last one that's left with, like, a big stun would be something like the Tidehunter, but then you're dealing with some mega cooldown. So it could be, like, maybe the more active Nightstalker we talked about last game.
Ooh, yeah, the Nightstalker. That could be interesting. Empire opt to ban out the Batrider with their fifth. Would have been a good offlane initiator for Escape, something that Kezu does definitely play. What is going to be the Kezu hero this game? Bristleback is something that he does like to play on occasion, but I really think they need someone with some stun, some kind of control. Like, a Magnus could actually be okay.
Oh, Beast is still in too, I suppose.
Oh, Beastmaster! Yeah, okay. I think he's the obvious choice here. Remaining. Iron Talon, get him in the jungle.
Really nice. Versus the Timbersaw too.
5 seconds. Yeah, remaining. Yeah, good point. The Mana Burn. Yeah, Timber kind of similar to like the Tinker in that sense. Like, without mana, he's really pretty useless.
I'd be pretty surprised if they didn't go with the Beastmaster. I feel like, you know, Sunstrike comboed up with it as well. It just seems very stable for them.
Yeah.
And then Team Empire, we're still assuming this will be the mid hero left as well, but they also, again, they run the Timbersaw mid and safe lane. So Escape are just like kind of taking their best shot at that Queen of Pain ban.
Yeah, I mean, Queen of Pain would have been annoying. I guess she can do pretty well in the lane against Invoker, but it really is a crapshoot. I think that's one of the scariest things about Timbersaw being your first pick. Remaining. He's a core, but you don't know exactly what you're going to do with him. And even Kunkka, third pick like that, there's still something in the back of my brain saying it could be a core Kunkka. It could be a core Kunkka. Escape will take the Sand King. That's most definitely the offlaner for Kezu. Caustic Finale does do pretty well against melee heroes. I think for Timbersaw, it's actually not so easy for him, so he'll definitely not want to be in the safe lane. Could Escape look to aggro try here and safe lane the Sand King to get the matchup against the Timbersaw and put a lot of pressure on the Slardar? Empire settle on the Alchemist last pick, so it is definitely a support Kunkka.
Yeah, I don't know. They're laning. It's going to be something pretty funky here, but I suppose we'll find out in a moment rather than just try and blind guess it.
Very true. Thank you.
Esport Live Score, the fastest esports scores.
Fanobet, go where the winners go.
10 seconds. All right, folks, welcome back. Still loading in from our draft. Actually, pretty slow load from these players, so probably going to move into a pause to get things started. But, yeah, overall thoughts here, Trent. The Alchemist last pick. Oh, no, there we go. The Alchemist last pick here for Empire. How you feeling?
I think that's good. I think it's the hero I probably... I was kind of going through their last picks in terms of like what they like to match up versus the Invoker, and they've done the Timbersaw for sure, but other than that, the Alchemist would be the pick if they are going to be sending this just safe lane once more for Ramzes, so pairs up really nicely. Sometimes they've done kind of a like Morphling-style gameplay with the same draft, where instead you replace like Disruptor with Kunkka, so it's still kind of the same idea, but the whole idea being you've got these heroes that are just ready to fight, and scaling later in the game... nothing goes too wrong, right? You've always got this kind of like backbone core and
right.
Scandal. He doesn't go quite as late as a Morphling, but anywhere from that, like, honestly, what's he have Armlet? Like, what's the downfall to
Alchemist? Uh-oh, Ramzes! It's a 5-on-1. The easiest first blood escape has ever seen. Oh, the poor Timbersaw, just the wrong place at the wrong time. Their jungle invade yields a successful first blood. Very nice. It's actually Syndrome that gets credit for the kill, so he'll get the bulk of that bonus gold.
All right, nice. Yeah, and Kangar getting rolled on as well, but it'll just be some harass. Nice, gets the telekinesis forced out.
All right. So, yeah, I saw some people in chat saying Tidehunter instead of the Sand King. That would have been a pretty good pick here, honestly, for escape. A lot of team fight, you know, a good mech carrier.
I think his cooldown was too long. Like, Beastmaster would have been, like, 5 times better than Tidehunter in my eyes.
Yeah, they just want to fight more regularly than that Ravage cooldown. I could definitely understand that. Alchemist as well as Invoker going to get the first 2 bounty runes, and looks like I might have actually called this one right. Escape Gaming gearing up for an aggro tri-lane. Yapzor will rotate mid. He drops a lane ward down here to help out his Invoker buddy, but they're going to go down and pressure Afterlife so they can get this matchup of Kezu on the Sand King versus the Timbersaw. Looks like it will be a 2-1-2 coming out from Empire, though. Rubick rotating up top to try and babysit Ramzes a bit. I do think Caustic Finale is a good tool against the Timber. Reactive Armor does not mitigate much damage from the Caustic Finale magic damage. Unfortunately, though, Sand King is still a melee hero, so he is susceptible to that Whirling Death Harass.
Yeah, I'm not sure. Like, maybe a couple points in the Caustic Finale. We'll see it. I mean, we saw a little bit of that mid Sand King. I believe it is versus a Dragon Knight and had a hell of a time, but versus that Timber. That Whirling Death, man. It all depends on the build Ramzes goes, of course, and how much he wants to sacrifice rotations versus in-lane dominance.
Yep. Afterlife off to an okay start. Just 2 last hits out of the gate, but not really zoning him out too much. Yapzor just kind of staying down bottom for now, but they may start rotating about. Cinderin's already gone to the top lane, so for escape, it's turned into a 2-1-2, so they can try to secure some farm for Kezu. Fairly even laning stage so far there. I think a lot of pressure on this Kunkka. Maposhka goes for a Windlace at level 1, but he definitely needs to make some plays happen. At the very least, needs to find some experience. This hero, not really too useful until he hits level 2, level 3.
Yeah, and there won't be any pull down here to help that or help up with that either. It's a little bit disappointing. Then, of course, with the overall pressure they're putting on here, it's not like a pull would be too handy. Top lane, Ramzes in here deep. Look at that damage from the heal bomb from Syndra.
Yep, he's going to be able to survive, though, it looks like. No point in Timber Chain, but the reactive armor gonna be enough to help him regen up. Now bottom, Chessie at Afterlife, still trading blows, but pretty much just a farm fest for the most part.
Kind of bold to put a nice play at the rune.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, did a toss up there onto Yapzor using the torrent and stole the invis.
Kind of a bold play though, to go for an offlane Juggernaut here. I think Empire could make some rotations and make this tough, but it's gonna be a rotation the other way. Afterlife gets rotated on by Yapzor, Chessie trying to chase him down. Not going to dive into the tower. Slardar with sprint, 2 points in sprint rather, and boots. Just going to be a little too fast. Koikva initiated onto the mid lane. Will get off the ghost walk, and he does survive. Meanwhile, up top now, Ramzes getting dove. Kezu will get credit for that kill. TP in from Kangar might be able to find a recovery kill, and he does. Dazzle not going to be able to save himself. No point in Grave. He's only level 2, but limited options there. But, yep, feeling the power of the Sand King against the Timbersaw. He's going to go into Kangar. Not enough mana for a stun, but he does have a couple of stick charges. Not enough to get himself stun ready, but man, look at all this pressure in all the lanes.
Yeah, that pressure is so important, though, from Kezu. trying to slow down Ramzes this time. And look how much experience he missed out on. There was like 7 creeps left or something when Gengar came in for that kill. And so Ramzes is going to be relatively low on the experience now.
Yep. They are going to pull a rotation, though. Ramzes is going to go bottom. They're going to try to get this Timbersaw away from the Sand King matchup. We're going to initiate it on by Yapzor Syndrome. 2 points in reactive armor. He should be pretty okay here. The right clicks almost help him regen more over time. Now it's going to be Keizu versus Afterlife. Still not really a good matchup for Empire. Slardar has a similar struggle as the Timbersaw against the Caustic Finale.
Oh yeah, this is just like even harder too, because you cannot spam Slithering Crush as much as a Timbersaw is going to be able to with his Whirling Death.
Right. And you don't have that regen. At least the Timbersaw, if he pulls some creeps, he'll get some reactive armor charges, right?
Oh yeah, like his life's just totally fine in that sort of situation. So the bottom lane though, I mean, the Juggernaut's still going to be okay, but I don't think they'll be able to deny Ramzes' farm. He should be alright, I guess, depending on how much Gengar wants to
have. Oh, what a play from Koikva. He snipes the Bounty Rune with a Tornado. That is actually huge. We've seen with an Alchemist pick, those early Bounty Runes make such a big difference, and deny him like that does slow his roll. They are going to get a kill on Koikva, it looks like. Kill will go to Rubick after he eats the Fairy Fire. But now, the Cavalry has arrived. Double damage rune up on Yapzor. Has the stun to interrupt the TP, and Kingar in a lot of trouble. Nice heal from Cinderin sets it up. They may still try to go on Scandal. He's only level 5, so no ultimate, no big regen. They get the Oob debuff. They'll slow him down a bit, but not going to have enough for a kill. Just harass him to about half HP, and Escape Gaming will go back to it. Oh boy, a lot of action here in this early game.
And I was just taking a look, and you know, you talk about struggling with experience. Maposhka just cracked level 2. So this Kunkka not quite able to come online yet. Mid lane, they're diving again.
Yep, Scandal actually gets hit by the EMP, loses all of his mana, but Maposhka's here, looking for an X, can't quite get it. Torrent will be off the mark. And nice. Scandal will survive. That's what's important.
He read that one pretty perfectly. Cancels Maposhka's clarity. Both of them losing on some mana regen here.
Yeah,
Koikva's coming up.
Still a lot of rotations here. Nice stun on 2 from Yapzor. Koikva on the way. He's going to have another EMP in about 1 second. He's already invoked Cold Snap.
Oh, bottom lane. They're after Ramzes, but maybe he'll be okay.
Yeah, 1 point in Timber Chain. He should be able to make it out. He actually turns and tries to fight. Now the Grave onto Chessie. I think Ramzes should be good here, and yeah, he'll make it back to tower range. I say Alchemist just now hit level 6. That window of opportunity for Escape to easily pick on him has since closed, but also worth noting, Koikva going for Quas Wex, a notoriously Exort Invoker. That's generally what he plays. They don't have a lot of setup for it, so I guess the Quas Wex does make a little more sense here. But a little out of character from Koikva, showing that Escape are doing things a bit differently.
Yeah, it's going to be nice. Again, more mana burn here. We talked about like the Beastmaster idea behind that, but up against the Timbersaw, that's always going to be handy. It's going to really help set up for Keizu. Even if he has a Blink Dagger, it can be really hard to get that perfect epicenter off.
Yep. Yapzor rolling about. Cinderin caught by an X. He's going to get pulled back. Maposhka sets this kill up. No Shallow Grave. Still on cooldown. Not enough mana anyhow. He's in pretty deep, and he will get punished for dropping those sentries. Does block out a couple of camps, though. Will block out the hard camp here, as well as the medium camp. Trying to slow down the farming space for Alchemist. They will notice pretty quick. I mean, they're only sentries, so they do expire pretty quick as well, but still a noble effort to try and slow down the Alph. Ramzes down bottom, initiated on. Chessie gets off the Omni Slash. It's almost enough damage. The Blade Fury's there to finish him off. Now Maposhka thinking about an X, but Chessie's Blade Fury will last long enough to get out. And it's just a quick pick on the Timbersaw. Nice setup there for Escape.
Yeah, that was really nicely done. And now right on the Maposhka again.
Maposhka! Nice heal bomb from Cinderin. Actually gets the setup for Chessie. He'll get credit for that kill. Double kill on the Juggernaut. And Escape looking a lot better this game, man. This Sand King's having a great time in the safe lane. They're actually holding on to a decent advantage, even with this Alchemist farming well.
Yeah, everything just looking much crisper and cleaner. That Omni Slash gank isn't that easy to execute up against the Timber. Like, Ramzes is obviously extremely mobile, can position himself near the creep very easily, but Yapzor with some good silence and kick plays just to put him in a spot that's going to make that more difficult. And yep. Speaking of which, Yapzor, fine Scandal.
Yeah, they did a really good job just chasing the Timbersaw into kind of an odd corner where they were able to get off that Omni Slash with all those creeps nearby. Armlet now comes out onto the Alchemist, and the rest of Empire starting to rotate into the jungle. By the way, this Kunkka is level 2. I don't know what the hell's going on with this, but he's in trouble, man. Like, he needs to really find some space to farm and start to recover.
I gotta say, that Alchemist is pretty scary, though. Like, 4600, Armlet, and before the 8-minute mark, that's definitely one of those timings that, if I was on the enemy team, gets me a little bit worried, you know? Getting to some point. But they do have the Juggernaut, which is one of, like, the best cores when it comes to coming in early into this jungle and scouting out some of these stacks, and we've had Yapzor roaming around. Unfortunately, they're not gonna find this one.
Yeah, that's true. This one's going to go to the Alchemist. He's got a double damage rune as well, so it makes it even easier. But I think Escape still have a pretty good window. It's going to come online in a couple minutes, but 10 to 15, 15 to 20 is when they're going to want to fight a lot. They'll have the Invoker with some decent levels, Quaswex to help set things up. What's he have? I wonder what first core item he's going to go for, if he goes for the Orchid or if it's something a little bit different. But they've got Magnetize, they've got Omni Slash. Oh, Chessie down bottom. Big damage, he will survive. But more importantly, Sand King. That Epicenter with all the damage he can put out, that's something that the Alchemist will be very vulnerable to, even with the Armlet. They'll have a lot of magic damage to bring him down.
Yeah, it's true, and that's really handy against that Timbersaw too. Just reactive armor not going to be all too handy up against all that magic damage. So it could even be a very good game for a Veil, like Blink Veil or something, if Kezu wants to go for that instead of a Force Staff afterwards. But you start to look at the way that they're prioritizing experience. We're talking about this Kunkka so much, but they're giving this full mid to King R right now. And Kunkka forced ahead top. Well, speaking of mid.
Well, speaking of bottom as well, Ramsey's the one that gets initiated on. Huge damage here. He tries to Timber Chain away. There is an Omni Slash, but not enough mana. Oh, what a bittersweet ending. Escape really should have had that kill. But the Jug just doesn't have the inventory space right now to... Even if that was just an upgraded stick into a wand, might have had the mana for it. It was pretty close. How unfortunate. Oh, Yapzor. He actually goes in too deep. Another stun. Is he going to bait Ramsey's out here? Chessie still doesn't have the Omni Slash. He needs a few more charges on that stick. He's just going to spin instead. Ramsey's will be able to Timber Chain away. Afterlife now rotates in. And Chessie could be in trouble. More supports rotating. Crush connects. He's already got the amp damage on Chakram, bringing him low. Dazzle does manage to kill the Kunkka off to the side, but the Juggernaut will fall. Now the Koikster joining the fray, goes in onto Ramsey's, gets the kill. EMP connects onto Scandal, but Koikma could be in a world of hurt, trying to juke, jive, and dip. Slithering Crush will connect, though, and the Koikster will fall. Not the fight that Escape were hoping for. It will be an advantage here for Empire. About a 750 net worth swing, though all the while they are pressuring that Tier 1 top, so that will help level things out a bit, but still good news for Empire.
And we were just talking about the crisp plays there, but then two quick, like, very narrowly missed ganks, one on the Rubick in the mid and one on the Timbersaw bottom, resulting in some big turnaround plays here from Empire. Now Kezu possibly the next to fall.
Yep, he does just barely make it away. That last tower shot follows him, though, not able to disjoin it. That'll be another kill, a freebie for Empire. Dude, this Alk is really starting to get scary. At the point when you said he's got the great timing on the Armlet, I would agree. But he's still vulnerable. Now he's getting close to this Relic. And if this keeps up, he's going to have a super fast Radiance now. Cinderin caught up top. Kingar sets it up. Mephosto with the X-Torrent follow-up. The Shadow Priest falls. The Kunkka hits 6. And things looking even better for Empire. This is all space created for the Alchemist. Uh-oh. Afterlife caught by the EMP. Cold Snap slowing him down. But they can't get the kill. Another kill denied to Team Escape. This is getting painful.
It feels like they're so close to these kills, and at the very least they're like forcing them back, right? Like, you can get this pressure on the tower, but unfortunately being a Quaswex Invoker, Cloak just doesn't have that same hitting power to just immediately start busting this one down. But this is where it comes in. Kazu's got a Blink Dagger. Man, ready to make some rotations. Gonna be blinking on people, pressing buttons, hitting skills.
Alright. I have some faith. The Sand King is a huge damage dealer, but they gotta force the team fight to make it happen. These odds still, similar to for the first game, still pretty much in favor of Team Escape right now. A little surprised it hasn't, still in favor of Empire. I misread those numbers. Not surprising. They are in control of this series, and they are in control of this game. Let's see if Escape can win a fight and maybe shift those odds around a bit. Now Scandal goes in on the Koikva. EMP not going to do enough. Rubick able to secure the kill. Is that a stolen heal? It sure is. He's got Shadow Wave. That's a great spell to have. Huge Magnetize from the Yapzor. Cinderin buys him the time to keep it alive. Kezu follows up with a massive ult. They shut down 3, soon to be 4 as Mapochka dies. Oh my, that was the inverse caster curse right there. Escape Gaming finally get the combo that they needed. It's about an 1800 net worth swing. Trent, they might have just shown a sign of life in this game. The Timbersaw, the only one that doesn't die there.
Yeah, pretty much. Coming in, some big plays there. Coming all together, and Despite having that DD rune, I think Koikka probably would have lived if it wasn't for the fact that it was a DD Alchemist. He just took damage quicker than he was expecting, so... Escape game, they're doing it, man. They brought down the Alph, they're gonna slow that progression. And they should get this mid-tier one.
Yeah, Maposhka TP's in, they're gonna mount a defense here. Ramses might be in some trouble, but the boat flies through. Chessie gets stunned. He will be able to Blade Fury out, at least for now. Afterlife trying to chase in, connects with a crush on two. Syndrant has a grave up in about 2 seconds. Tornado flies in, stolen from Rubik. Kezu reinitiates again, still doesn't have the ultimate. It's down for quite a while. It's a great time for Empire to pick a fight. Koikka, the one that gets the shallow grave as Kezu goes the other way. Chessie gets off another Blade Fury. The Healing Ward doing so much work, it keeps him alive as Syndrant drops the Shadow Wave again. Somehow, everyone's still alive. Escape the ones on the back foot. They will split in different directions, and Empire won't be able to secure any of those kills. What a crazy back and forth to have everyone still alive.
Yeah, I'm not sure how they made it out of that one. First, the kind of whiff tornado there from Koikka, then the stolen from King Air gets it on two, but not enough of them.
Look at that gold graph, though, dude.
Oh, yeah, that's something else, eh?
That is a serious sign of life. Maposhka, is he going to set this up mid? He's thinking about it. He's looking at Chessie like, boys, we can make a play here. Boat, Torrent, they're going to be on the money. Follow up Fade Bolt. He barely gets off the Blade Fury. King R just a little too slow with the Tornado. I think that would have been a sure kill if he connected there. A noble effort.
Yeah, Skate. I guess he must have just been too far away when Maposhka started that combo to like just go in for a lift. Because it should have just been an open and shut case on that one, you'd think.
Yeah, no doubt. Now... I'll see another fight break out. I really did want to relook at that fight, the kind of the turning point in this game, because it is really significant for Escape. Before this, it seemed like a pretty dismal matchup. We're going to move into our global Grandmaster instant replay here. This is the fight that turned it around. Empire were pretty happily in control with their Alchemist farming, and it even looked like a good start for them. Koikka gets initiated on. He gets off a decent EMP, but gets blown up right away. The stolen Shadow Wave from... Uh-oh, are we going to see a kill up top? Is Alchemist actually going to get initiated on in the real game? Omni Slash will be used, and that'll just be a quick pickoff. But a super convincing fight, even with the Invoker dead. It's a ridiculous setup. The Sand King reveals the Blink Dagger after 4 Hero Magnetize. And honestly, it was that grave from Syndrome that made the whole thing possible. It kept Yapzor alive long enough to get off that big Magnetize and get everybody in the threshold for the Sand King to come and clean up. Beautiful execution from Execration. Syndrome stunned by the boat. And no follow-up from Empire. That's it. It's just a boat down.
And now coming up in. Looks like they might just back away. I don't know. This is kind of scary. They have the spin, though, so it's kind of hard to initiate on Chessie. Now there'll even be a smoke up here. No Radiant Vision there, so Kezu trying to be a little bit sneaky, trying to get off a nice epicenter.
Yeah. They don't have Afterlife with him. His TP's down for another few seconds. Kind of odd positioning for Empire. They are going to get initiated on. It's Ramses that gets caught first. Kezu thinking about that ultimate, but doesn't channel it. It's just a pump fake. Ramses getting low. He'll actually be the first to die. Koikka getting credit for that kill. That is the ideal start for Escape Gaming. Timbersaw, one of their biggest damage dealers right now. Slardar still nowhere to be found, hanging onto that TP. Looks like this will just be a free tier 2 tower for Escape after all. I don't think they can defend it without the Timber.
No, and this is looking so good for Escape. I mean, this is the time of the game where they needed to put on pressure so badly. And for a long while now, it has been this, like, kind of top four have been Alchemist and then three heroes from Escape. So they definitely won out on a lot of their lanes, right? Things did go well. I mean, we saw how good Kezu did up top. But now they're actually turning that into real pressure on the map. They're trying to deny the space to the Alchemist. And yeah, he got his Radiance, but... in the end, you can't really deny it. It's going to happen for the most part.
I mean, it's still not over for Empire. Alchemist is farming okay. It's coming at the cost of the rest of the team. This is pretty typical in these sort of games with an Alchemist. Once you lose map control, you can kind of draw this imaginary line here. And that's the only spot on the map that it's safe for Empire to farm. Scandal, living life on the edge a little bit, has to take some risk for farm. He's the one that's absorbing all this, though. He's the vacuum cleaner. Everyone else on Empire cannot find space to farm at all. Chessie gets initiated on here in the mid. Oh, boy. He gets a grave. He might actually be able to live. Kezu nearby. He eats some stick charges. They're going to keep him alive. It's a great play from Syndrome. The Shadow Priest coming in handy is now Kezu. Caught by a bash, he gets caught by a torrent as well. That's just a little bit unlucky. He was about to burrow strike away. Now Yapzor knocks back Scandal. Are they going to get more here? Is it a turn the other way? 3-0. Empire managed to clean it up. These fights are ridiculous. Just as it looks like it's about to go one way, it completely swings to the other. This is some of the Alchemist factor, though, coming online with the Radiance.
Uh-oh. Dire's Courier
what?
Gets picked off.
He hunted that courier for so long. That was actually impressive. He, like, got it up onto the high ground, then he got the ultimate off onto the courier, and then he just blinked on in the trees. That was pretty nice. Some solid tracking down.
Mm-hmm.
Tier 1 tower gonna fall, and do we dare look at this gold graph, that 3k gold lead that Team Escape picked up for themselves. Completely zeroed out. Empire takes the lead again.
Yeah, a little bit of a recession coming out there, I guess, here.
Did I say execration earlier by accident?
Yeah, you might have. It might have happened.
Son of a bitch.
Hey, man.
What can I say? I've been watching
team,
too much
you know,
Sea Dota
out of nowhere
recently.
In the qualifiers. They came out of nowhere in this cast. It's all the same thing. I wouldn't worry about it.
Getting trolled by execration. My God. But more than a sign of life for Empire now, this is where Alchemist starts to get kind of scary. He's got his BOTs. He's got his Yasha. A lot of movement speed. Once he gets Manta Octarine, Alchemist can just take over the map. And you look at that net worth, 13k compared to the 7k of Juggernaut. We are getting to that scenario where he is scary. And there are Aghanim's upgrades here. Timbersaw, one of the better Aghanim's upgrades. That'll open up for him to get something else. And, you know, he's also a hero that can run into slot issues. So there's a lot of synergy there. Rubick, a fantastic Aghanim's carrier. That means he can comfortably just go for mobility items like Four Staff Link Dagger. And Kunkka, he's got an Ags upgrade. I don't know how good it actually is, but hey, it's an Ags upgrade nonetheless.
Yeah, Ramsey's actually, like, just moments ago, he was, like, 2k below that kind of trio on the side of Escape, and now he's caught up to them, up to 6,200. In fact, he just leapfrogged right over top of Kezu, so his whole game, you know, 2, 5, and 3, not having a very good start, not having a very good lane. He's starting to build up into that Bloodstone, and that just means that, yeah, it's up now. This fight for them is just massive, right? Like, you know, you take 2 or 3 kills right now, get Ramsey up to 14, he can easily start farming around the map. And that window from Escape starts to close. We talk about the pressure that they need. Now they're kind of sat back right now. They're having a hard time applying that pressure, and you can't have that versus the Alchemist.
Yep, you're absolutely right. Chessy, just going back for a farming tool here. He still hasn't picked up a core item yet. It's just going to be Phase Boots into Battle Fury. We're 20 minutes in. If he was in a pub game right now, he would be getting flamed by his teammates so hard for this Battle Fury timing. And I mean, he hasn't played poorly, but it's just been a rocky game. He's 3-1-7. He spent a lot of time moving around, picking up kills, which is what the Jug needs to do. But it does sort of conflict with that basic Battle Fury strategy. If this is the build you want to go for, you really want to spend a little more time in lane, farming those last hits and rushing the Battle Fury as quickly as possible. I mean, is the Alchemist too far ahead at this point? Is this where you go for more just like combative items, like you get your SNY, or you go right into your Manta and just start fighting, or do you think this is the right call to go back to a farming tool and try to close that gap in a more defensive posture?
That can always be tough. I think it's at this point it almost needs to have come down to player preference in some ways. Like some people just preferring that more defusal Manta style of a build with the SNY, and others still preferring this farming build of the Battle Fury. But In this game, it's going to help push out the waves, right? There's going to be a lot of map pressure coming out just in general from the Alchemist and even the Timbersaw. So Chessy will be able to provide a little bit of that kind of fire mode on his own. They don't have any BKB Pierce besides the Bash, so as long as he doesn't get really unlucky, he should be able to just spin TP in some of the more dire situations.
Okay, all right, that's a fair point. And I guess on that same token, Empire really don't push well this game. We talked about it last match, and I mean, Alchemist eventually pushes pretty well just because he gets so much damage and attack speed that he can just chunk down structures, but he's still pretty far away from that. So I guess it does stand to reason that Escape will have time to farm and make use of that. The Sand King has just gone all mobility tools here. They will drop a scan. It reveals the presence of at least a few heroes. It's Kingar and Ramsey's hiding in the tree line. Escape grouped up his 5 Empire, ready to contest any kind of a push here. Manta style now up on the Alchemist, so he can scout, he can harass. He's actually pretty scary. In goes Chessy, he'll start up this fight. Maposhka, the one that gets initiated on. Out comes the ultimate from the Earth Spirit. Who's actually going to get the first kill? It's the Slardar that falls. They lose their Dazzle right away. He gets a Grave off onto Kezu, but it's Empire that are taking the fight. Chessy's ult just didn't do enough damage. His teammates have gone down. It's a 2-for-2. The Magnetize doing so much work, but they will lose the Rubick. Scandal still alive, channeling a stun, will go in to finish off the Jug. Now Koikla does have an invoke, gets a Ghost Walk, and I don't think they have
they
the detection.
They need to kill Scandal. Like, they need to try something on this guy. They can't kill him mid-fight if his ultimate goes off without Epicenter. There's just no way. I can't see the damage coming out.
That was a really chaotic team fight where it started as a cluster and then it broke into all these little skirmishes. And in the end, it's a 3-for-3, and I would say kept surprisingly even, given that it feels like Empire have a pretty strong advantage right now, and they are holding on to that net worth lead. I mean, Alchemist does still get a lot out of that fight. He's up to 18k net worth now, so it's certainly not bad for Empire, but if Escape Gaming had dropped the Epicenter in that fight, if the initiation had just gone a little bit better, it would have been a completely different story. Like, Escape totally could have taken that fight. It's impressive how close all of these team fights have been.
Yeah, well, they're very lucky they didn't lose the Alchemist, too, just because of his massive, like, 10k over top of that Invoker. And you look at the net worth graph, like, right, this is what we always got to keep in mind whenever it's an Alchemist game. There's Alchemist, and then there's four heroes. Okay, well, now it's starting to get mixed up a little bit here, but there's the vast majority of this top half is still Dire Scythe heroes. True. So there is a lot of firepower coming out from between our Juggernaut, our Invoker, and even Kezu, who didn't get to show it off during that last fight. So it does mean that despite having that giant lead, the fights can still be relatively even, and if you just blow up this Alchemist, that comeback gold mechanic kicks in because of that lead that your team still has, and it can be pretty, you know, kind of detrimental during that overall gold game.
Wow, Slardar picks up a Hand of Midas. Both teams kind of feeling like this game's not going to be ending soon, and they want to invest in some farming tools that'll help propel them towards the late game. Not a bad choice on the Slardar. He does benefit a lot from attack speed with the built-in buff, so I do think it's a decent item choice. Roche falling very slowly for Escape. They are committed to the pit right now. Empire, they're on their way in. They've smoked up. Ramses goes charging on forward. Chakram to get it started. Syndra with good positioning outside the pit. Should be able to get off a decent shallow grave. He does save Chessie, but Koikla falls almost immediately. Now Syndra gets scouted out. Afterlife goes in hard. The Juggernaut not going to survive long enough to get off his ult. Crush will be off the mark. Sin surviving for now, but he's on the run and will be brought down by Scandal. It's a triple kill for the Alchemist and a disastrous setup for Escape Gaming. It's going to be a 2100 net worth swing, and Empire with the manor pause afterwards to sit back and count their spoils.
Yeah, I thought that was going to be Kezu pausing to plug in his keyboard. So I think this is an issue where Tidehunter might have been one of those choices, because you look at timings and cooldowns and everything, and well, it's relatively close when it comes to Epicenter and Sand King and everything, but Kezu just, it's so hard to find those moments, you know. Tidehunter, he just goes in, he ravages, and sometimes it's a little bit brainless, but at least the spell goes off, you know. Kezu has to spend so much time calculating, and yes, that fight started out pretty awful, just the way that they came into the pit and everything, but there's just no, like, zoning potential from this Sand King. I don't know how Kezu's supposed to fight into this right now.
Yeah, they're just having problems getting their ultimates off. It's really unfortunate. Even the Earth Spirit wasn't really in position to start that fight. Like, he didn't use Magnetize. You look at this in-game, they've got Epicenter, Omni Slash, even an Invoke. I think he had it up when he died because he just got bursted down so fast, and Magnetize available. The only ult they were able to use was Syndrin, who got off the Weave, and it helped. I mean, he did get off a good grave that was really good positioning, but in the end, it just wasn't enough. You need some damage output at some point here. The Jug, if he doesn't get the Omni Slash off, he dies pretty fast. I mean, he is a glass cannon right now. Phase Boots, Battle Fury, Aquila. He doesn't even have a poor man shield.
What to do?
What to do?
That's the question right now for Escape. They can't find that sink, you know? You can see it. There's a Tornado, there's an Epicenter, there's a Magnetize, there's a Kick through 5, you know? Picturing a little bit of Jerax, Dota here or something. I mean, Yapsor equally as skilled in the Earth Spirit. This guy gets all the praise in the world as well. But it seems to be like maybe his early game always goes a little bit better than his actual big team fights and everything like that. Like, I'm not getting wowed, man. This Magnetize, it's so good versus the Armlet. It was what got Scandal earlier.
Trent, my Dota crashed.
That's okay. We're still paused.
Oh, boy. I was trying to look at effigies, and I went out of showcase mode, and Reborn said, "You idiot! Why would you want to look at an effigy in showcase mode? You're off the server."
You're done.
You're out, kid.
Well...
All right, I'm back. I'm loading in.
Is this going to be like last game where we just get into this like painful long time? They have to turn around soon. It has to be the big wombo combo. I still feel good about the state of their general cores for sure. It's just like Scandal needs to die. We got to kill that guy.
Yeah, absolutely. This is getting close to insurmountable. Now 21k net worth on the Alchemist, 9.5 on the Juggernaut. Like, the Alch is just farming so much more rapidly than all these other heroes. And he's really not that close to capped out yet. He still has just a casual Quelling Blade. He's going to go Octarine next. He can grab a full another item in that Quelling Blade slot and then still replace the Armlet before he starts pulling Aghanim's Scepters. Though, honestly, I think dropping an Aghanim's on this Timbersaw sooner rather than later would be really handy. I mean, it does absurd damage.
Yeah, it'd actually be fantastic. Dude, he's sitting at 18 Bloodstone charges. There's so much mana to work with there that typically you'd have a problem with the Aghanim's early on. Not this game.
Yeah, no doubt. Tier 1 tower still standing in the bottom lane, but escape with so many heroes dead. They move right into the Roche pit, and well, with that minus armor from the amp damage, it's nice and quick. Alchemist now with an Aegis of the Immortal, 6, 2, and 8. It's been a while since he died. Probably going to be a while since he dies again. Poshka getting a little bit of solo time down bottom. Goes for the Aether Lens on the Kunkka, pretty common. When you see Kunkka on the position 4, get that X marks the spot from further back.
Yeah, he's almost got a blink too.
Yeah, he's in really good shape. If he gets this tower kill, he's going to be really close to it.
I like this too, the farming boat.
Yeah.
I miss this hero. You know, Lyrical. I know he was calling for this hero during all the qualifiers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Lyrical's a big Kunkka fan. I chatted with him about it. Kunkka is one of my favorite heroes. He's like my guilty pleasure hero. I got like a 25% win rate, but I love playing him, you know? My Kunkka loses games, for sure. Still fun, though.
Yeah, no, I hear y'all those.
Oh. Kind of like Pudge. That's my other guilty pleasure hero. I think that's everybody's guilty pleasure hero.
Definitely the biggest hit or miss hero that there. Well, okay, I didn't mean that like quite so literally, but I guess it is very literally, you know.
Yeah. Octarine Core up on the Alchemist already has another 2,300 gold to work with. Aegis of the Immortal in the slot for now, but I think a Heart of Tarrasque could honestly be a nice next choice for him. He may just go for the Assault Karas. They want to close out this game pretty soon. Just helps the sieging, that minus armor on towers.
It's a really good Shiva's game too, just because of like stopping the blinks in from Kezu can be really nice, or stopping his general escape.
Yeah, though I think the Timbersaw, well, I was going to say might be more likely to get the Shiva's, but he's actually going to go the Pipe route. He has 100 Defiance now. Empire, they're not messing around. They're going to go right into this top tier 3 tower. No glyph available, and this is actually a pretty good push. Cindering caught by the boat. He does get off a shallow grave, but not a big difference it will make. Maybe Force Staff will be enough to keep him alive, though. The Yule Scepter does buy him some time. Regardless, Escape are still being relegated back, and their barracks are exposed, taking heavy damage. It seems like they just can't take this fight. Tornado comes in from the Invoker. Chessie thinking about an Omni Slash, moving forward. Scandal mans up. Definitely does not want to use the Omni Slash on the Aegis Carrier. But what's the angle to initiate here? Which target do they jump on? Yapzor says, I found Scandal Boys, I'm dropping the Magnetize. But he gets stunned up, takes a lot of right clicks, forces a Grave out of the Dazzle. It will keep Yapzor alive, he's able to roll back, gets out of the Radiance Burn, but Sindarin taking so much damage here, the Illusions alone destroying the support line of Escape Gaming. Koikva unable to do much damage here, and they will watch the Barracks slowly fall. This is tough for Escape Gaming, there is just nothing they can do here. If they commit more, they're just gonna get cleaned up.
You're in desperation mode when you're invoking a 3 Exort Meteor right now.
Yeah, this is really quite brutal. These odds not changing at all. The fans have spoken. They know that Empire are the heavy favorites here. Nobody else jumping ship. Tier 3 tower mid, taking heavy damage from this Alchemist. He's at the point now where he can just slap this baby down with his ult. He's happy to tank it. 2 minutes left on the Aegis. He's feeling pretty safe. Oh, what an X on Chessie. He's coming in for the Omni Slash. They slow him down. He gets stunned up. He'll get brought down before he can Omni Slash. Oh, that poor Juggernaut. Now Yapzor trying to Rolling Boulder away, but not going to get out. Scandal intercepts it. Nice stun from Kezu, but they're just slowing him down. It seems like Scandal is unkillable right now. He is a complete raid boss, 26k net worth. Chessie in trouble again. He's bought back. He gets Shallow Grave this time. Just use the Omni Slash. Just use it. He gets it off. King R actually dies. It's a decent setup onto Ramses as well, but now the stun from Alk bringing him low. Rubick will die. He buys back. Can he get back into the fray, though? He TPs to the Tier 2 tower. It's going to be a long run back to the enemy base. They lose the Slardar, but now they go right back onto the structures. No glyph for 2 minutes. This should be another melee barracks down. Scandal with his ult.
They
still
can't kill him.
Has the Aegis. I mean, what do they do here?
They can't. They can't kill him without Invoker and Jug. It's actually impossible. Without Epicenter, they just quite literally don't have the damage to kill him.
Yeah, this game is totally over. 21 to 18, it's close in hero kills, but my god, Scandal farmed like a madman. They are ahead now by 25k net worth. This is brutal.
Oh, they just realized there's still a tier 2 tower, so they will head back to the tier 1.
The hero tier 2 may be keeping Escape Gaming in this a little bit longer. Empire probably wondering why they haven't tapped out by now. Maposhka just buys his Blink Dagger at the enemy shop. Alchemist with 7,500 gold. That Aegis about to expire. He hasn't even had to buy another item yet. Like, 8k of this net worth lead is just sitting in that bank account, providing absolutely zero value.
I'd like to see him just go buy, like, a Necro 3 during this whole exchange right now, you know? Just pop and start sieging.
Well, they're going to finish off the tier 4 towers, and that's it. Quick was going to call it. Good game, well played. That will knock Escape Gaming down to the lower bracket for the Global Grandmaster Playoffs. Empire, they're moving on to the semifinals of the upper bracket. Congratulations. They will be facing Liquid or Power Rangers next. That series coming up in about 2 hours' time. We've got a long break. It will start at 20 CET later today. We'll see who wins that matchup. What a series, though, from Empire. A brilliant showing. Both games very convincing. Good win
much,
over
much
Escape.
More convincing than we expected.
Why didn't Empire play like this in the qualifiers?
Yeah, maybe, you know, Escape, maybe missing Era, not quite having that synergy. We talked about how it did seem to be a lot of kind of sync issues coming out here, but for the most part, it seemed to be mostly the core group that were kind of having that trouble, the actual team members. So all credit to Empire, though. They honestly just played better, you know, better map movements, better strategies overall, better use of teamfight coordination. Like, we saw so many of these games decided by them kind of smoking up, going in the jungle, and finding that engagement that they needed. They were on the back foot in this game for sure. And they brought it right back.
No, absolutely. And even this game, too, it's a pretty creative draft. They use the support Kunkka. We've seen other teams experiment with it, but still not the easiest hero to pull off, and they did it pretty convincingly. You know, even sniping with Slardar, denying that pick. I like the way Empire went about this draft. Worth reiterating, though, Chessie's standing in for Era today. Don't read too much into it, folks. I think Era's just traveling, and Chessie was available to play this quick best-of-three series, so I'm sure Era will be back in full form for the proper Escape squad in the matches to come. Do not fret, my fair friends, but always happy to see friends playing on friends' teams. Cool to see Chessie standing in with his Euro buddies. That'll do it for this series, though. I'm Ziori, he's ModPax. If you enjoyed the cast, please give us a follow on Twitter, at ZioriTV, and at ModPax, M-O-T-P-A-X, in the title of this broadcast. Big shout-out to our sponsor, Fanobet.com, for making this tournament possible. They've got live bets during the games, guys, so head over to that website, check it out. If you're of the betting variety, it's not a bad place to be. We're going to have a break. We'll let you know if this next match gets moved up, but for now, it's scheduled to start 2 hours from now, 2 o'clock p.m. Eastern Standard Time, 20 CET. We'll let you know if there's any updates.